All right, welcome to Advanced C, the series where I explained in small videos advanced concept of C. So in this video, I will explain what bit flags are and what problem we are trying to solve with them. So the initial problem is if you have I don't know, any function, and this function has a lot of Boolean flags to it. So for example, here you see I created a function that takes an int, and then it has three Boolean flag, is added, it is squared, and is not. And if the flag is true, I do an operation on them. And since, like in a more modern programming language like Python, you could do like is added equal this, like this. So it would be, because obviously if you use, if f is in a library, you don't really see the definition. And so if you don't put the name there, you don't really know what false true means, like what it does. And since you cannot name them, you have to find another way. And the way is bit flags. And also they take a lot less space on the stack, which is better optimized. So the way you do a bit flag is, I've seen two ways. So it's either this way. Up. So as you can see, all our flags will be inside one integer, one unsigned integer. And what you do is you set one bit of that integer for one flag. So for example, here in flag A, the first bit will be set. For flag number B, only the second bit will be set. And this way, you can replace all of this by T flag flags. And here, so I will first explain how to check if a flag is present. So what you can do is flags, and then you do bitwise AND, and then flag A. I didn't name them properly, but you understand. Up, copy paste this around. Up. C and flag B. And that's how you check for them. And then it's even better for. So the advantage on the function, the implementer's side, is there is only one argument for all the Boolean flags. And on the user side, the advantage if, for example, so for a start, if you don't want any flags to be true, you just say zero. Then here I want flag A to be true. I just say flag A, and then the other are false, so you just don't mention them. And then if I want flag B and C to be true, I do flag B or flag C. So that will create an integer that has the one bit set in both the second and third place. And then we can set it like this. And as you can see, it's a lot more readable. Another way I've seen the bit flags declared is with an enumeration. And it's basically the same. It's just in an enum, which I guess it doesn't make sense because it's not really enumerated, but I like it just because I just like to avoid macros whenever I can. And that's it. But yeah, they're basically the same. I mean, the only limit of those flags is you have 64 flags maximum, or whatever your register size is, but 64 flags is plenty. Also, if you use this in your function, and at some point it's sometimes useful to unset a flag, what you would do is flags, and then you do and equal, and then not flag A. I've used this a couple of times, so it will remove the flags from the flag list. And so this will basically end everything with the not of flag A. So every single bit besides flag A will be on, and then you end that together, and it will remove flag A. And yeah, to finish this, maybe a real world example is with the SDL library. So let's turn off the LSP. Up. And as you can see, that's how SDL is a graphic 2D graphic library to make video games and visualization and whatnot. And that's how you create a window. So you just say a title, position, size of the window. And then there is a bunch of Boolean flags, and you just use a OR between them, and it consumes. And if you actually look at the documentation of SDL, it's actually just a 32-bit unsigned integer. And if you go on this, you can see that there is a lot of Boolean flags. And so imagine a function with like 20 of those flags, it would be humongous. So yeah, thank God we have binary flags. So yeah, that's it for this one. It's a nice clean shortcut that you can use to make your functions cleaner. And hope this was useful, and see you.